Super. Let us go ahead and get ourselves going with our live session for 120A or 220A. The number of the course that we're following through the S series, but I sort of refer back to the original number that all the that the content is coming from. Okay. In terms of what we want to do today, it's like a live session just to answer questions and really help support what you're working on the assignments. So looking at sort of your current kind of progress and questions you're having about the first assignments is actually a good way to drive it, sort of always answer sort of the questions that you guys are having. So we have a volunteer of a model for our first section to go through and look at assignment one and answer some questions there. And then any questions come up that you're seeing here about your assignment, just jump on in and ask, because it's really very question driven and stuff like that. So as a general plan, we can kind of look at assignment one. We could also look at assignment two a little bit in terms of the differences as you're starting to think about modeling as two-story structure as opposed to a single-story structure. But I don't know, we'll see where it goes. It's always going to be very kind of question driven. So let me open your model and we will see kind of what kind of questions you have. We'll get it all recorded so everyone can see too. Okay, I gotta sort of find the model went. You're out there, it's win install. Let me find it over here. Did it show up on this side? Looks like it hasn't just yet. Let me try something in terms of mounting that just to make sure. Sharing. I'm just playing around with games because custom folder, I think it should have come over. Hang on just a second. W, no less. Okay, there you are. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look. You can walk us around a little bit and ask whatever you want to.
Sure.
Okay, so let us take a look at what's going on here. It looks like you're using the section box to scalp off the top, which is actually kind of a very effective way of checking things out.
So this is just one of the sections that I wanted to put in my sheet because my other one was just this large room, which is the workroom.
Okay, let's take a look at this one. So This one, it's like a section cutting vertically through it. The other one's more of a section cutting horizontally, so we're making like a 3D floor plan. Excellent.
I really, with the idea of a field research station, I wanted it to be open.
Sure.
Kind of make the researchers more creative or something. So I put windows everywhere.
Okay, so a lot of connection to the outside, so since they're all about this environmental center, they can be very connected. Very good.
Yes, and I, of course, didn't know if that was a great idea, but it's what I was thinking. So in the workroom, it's all the, what are they called?
These are double hung windows.
Yes,
those are ones that open, so the bottom slides out into the top, so they're all operable. We can get some cross ventilation because you have both sides.
Which is important to me. But then in the storage room, I thought, yes, we'd be storing stuff there, but maybe it wouldn't be so problematic to have it so visible. So I included windows there too, but I didn't make them
these are more fixed windows. So in these windows, it's more like a view. It's less of a ventilating thing. You'll get good daylight. Heat may build up in there a little bit. So that's something to kind of think about. It's almost like a good greenhouse.
What if I switched it to transom?
Maybe a combination might be kind of good. So let's take a look. So as we look at your windows, let's take a look over here. I'm going to see There's one thing I'm just noticing, so I'll just point it out to you right there. That window's just flipped. I can tell because it's sort of been set out. And how you can always spot it on a floor plan view is, let's go to, look at all these nice dimensions, arc dimensions no less, which are really hard to do.
Oh,
so,
they came up automatically when I was on annotate.
Oh, really? And then you
said,
oh, excellent. Oh, you can auto-dimension things. It's done a nice job automatically for that topic.
And I didn't know at which level to stop adding dimensions, so I added them for every window that was showing up. And speaking of windows, that's another question I have, but we can talk about that.
Okay, so I'm just going to flip that window. How you can tell if the windows are flipped is if you choose a window, the arrows will should be on the outside of it. Okay, so
that's and I think for the most part, I kept track of like being on the outside, mm-hmm. but maybe clicking around with the dimensions, I accidentally clicked this switch.
Oh, no worries. That happens. You got all the window tags. That looks super.
Except for my transom windows, because I couldn't figure out how to make my cutoff at the right height so I could view those.
Let's look at that. So let me ask if you do the whole thing about the automatic dimensions first, just because I'll show you sort of what I would typically do there. So for the dimensions, you put them on in there, and then where do you make the auto dimension? I'm trying to remember. So modify place dimensions. Because what I'll do here is, typically on this, I'll go through and have one more dimension. I'll do a dimension that goes from out here to out here, just so I sort of get an overall. Okay, and that way you sort of have them both covered. We have sort of the, you know, two, the typical way to do it is it's either two or there could even be three. It's usually an overall, and then we'll do two of the window openings. The third one, if it exists, although I don't think you have the condition, is just measuring to the interior walls. So sometimes, for example, a dimension you could add that, since you have the arc dimensions, you may not need. It's all just a question of providing as many as you can that you think will be helpful. Like, one dimension that's useful is this is like the overall, just from here to there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So another one that I'll do sometimes is I'll go from here and I'll basically just pick up this inside wall, either side of it, and then go to over there. So.
Oh, yes.
So that's useful too. Okay, but again, you're looking pretty good in terms of your dimensions. So I'm not worried about you all in terms of that. So you got all the tags, you got the furniture in there, that's looking good. I got the little 5-foot radius circle to kind of, or your diameter circle to kind of show how the bathroom's gonna work. That's a good time.
And so I didn't model my bathroom exactly after what we saw in the ADA compliant diagram, but I think I still followed the rules.
As long as you circle, you're in good shape. Generally, the rules are most important. It's kind of weird. The ones that they really care about is where the toilet is. Okay, the issue here is there's a dimension from here to there that they care about. Okay, and then they care about there's sort of a clear space in front here. But in general, I think you're doing okay.
Right.
So I'm not going to worry about your bathroom too much. If you're going to model it any other way, you could think about just maybe putting the sink over here.
Right.
And that would look a little more like the diagrams. But again, they're all just sort of guidelines
right.
for you know what's available. Now, in terms of just other little things, in terms of your design flexibility, for the bathroom, you like the doors opening out, which is actually the more proper way. They like bathroom doors to open out. It's a little bit easier to navigate in. Sometimes you'll see this, though. You'll see the door coming in like that, and that's okay too. Yeah, it can overlap that 5-foot circle. I'm pretty sure it can. I gotta check the rule on that. But sometimes you'll see that opening in. The way you have it set up is A-okay right now. Okay, now we're gonna look at some transom windows over there, and we'll look at the issue of why your transom windows don't show up. And it's like, I suspect you have some over here in the bathroom area, or where,
yes.
where are these higher windows? Okay.
I have some there, and then one in another place where the roof does this thing.
Got it. So it joins together near the top. Okay, let's go ahead and talk about that. So here's the deal. Oops. Clear that out. Go back over here. I'm just going to go to your default 3D view. We'll take a look. Okay. Now, that's just, it's scalped a little at the top. That's all that's going on. Your section box there. So the windows that typically give us troubles are like these windows. These higher windows that are up high. You see the top of them is at 6'11", okay. This is at like 7'0", 7'0", okay. So just generally, you might just make them an even 7 foot. They're probably just, they got shifted around just a little, you know, a half an inch or something like that. So 7'0" would be fine. Okay, the problem with them is the bottom is at 5 feet. And what happens is the cutting plane, where it's drawing the intersection with the windows and the doors and all that type of stuff, is lower. It's usually at 4 feet. Your bottom of your units are at 5 feet. So we create a special little region to help us. On the floor plan, we say, you know, overall, let's take a look at this.
And I tried doing that, and I set it to 6 feet, I think.
Yeah,
and
it didn't show.
Didn't.
Oh, is that what this is right here?
Yeah.
Well, let's check it out. Ah, yours is, it's the top, it's just your, you're actually above it right now. So the top of it is 7'6", that's fine. We're just gonna change this to 6 feet, right there, and that'll work. So they're gonna show up. So it's really in the same sense that there's the view range over here. Okay, there's the top, the middle, and the bottom, and then there's the lower depth. Let me even kind of tell you what the difference is between all those different things. Because it's kind of it's interesting, but it's just revitism. I'm gonna as though I'm drawing in a section right now. So you have the bottom. You have your cut, and you have your top. So there's top, there's cut, and there's bottom. And then you actually have this thing called depth. Okay, and let's talk about what happens in each of those. Cut is, that's the height at which it's gonna cut through, and it'll show if there's a door, there's a window, you're sort of seeing things there. So that's the one we usually care about the most about. And anything that's below it, for example, this desk right here, it is below the cut, okay? So it doesn't show with thick lines, it shows just kind of with what I'll call like natural lines, okay? So super. Things that are sort of here down sort of show as what I'll call natural, or just, you know, they're sort of just the way you'd sort of expect them. Or in its language, what it would say is that they're projected. So if you look at the whole thing about line widths and all that type of stuff, there's cut lines and projection lines. Those are projected, they're below us. Okay, above this, there actually is often some stuff that is shown above the cut line, but before the top, okay? And things like that are upper wall cabinets, things that are above 4 feet typically, okay? Those are shown in a line style called above, okay? And above is actually sort of an interesting line style. It's often a dashed line because you sort of want to indicate that it's above the viewing plane, but it's still sort of affecting us. So, oh, for example, if we were trying to indicate this something like a projection screen or something like that, that's above or something like that, if that was actually a consideration. So we can put that in there. This depth from here down there, that can actually show too, but it'll get a special line style called below. Okay, and what that's useful for is if you have like footings or things that are sort of below the floor, but you still want to see them, there's something in there that's supporting the floor. So you have the natural projection above and below, and that's what this view range thing does. So in terms of here, the top is that level, anything above it, we're just not going to see at all. Between cut plane and top, we're going to show the above style. Between cut plane and bottom, we'll show the normal. And then anything between bottom and view depth, was below. So if you did was just fine. I think you just had to adjust the height of the cut plane a little. Mm-hmm. But you're in good shape. Okay, so that's looking good. I got these little windows over here. Kind of like what you did for A, B. Do you have a C window yet?
No, that was supposed to be C.
You are now C. It's gonna change them on both. Okay, super. So that's looking good. Very nice use of the view region, that's good. Now let's talk about how we can sort of do a little double height window back in here. Maybe have a fixed window and a transom window above or below or something like that. It's a little hard to show on floor plan. That's the hard part. You can't really sort of see it very well. But let's do it in the elevation view. Okay, so if I go out and I look at your elevation, it's kind of funny. You can actually just click on the head of that. It'll take us out there. So what is this? This one's at 7, that's at 7. Why is that at 7? Oh, watch out for this. The height that it's measured from, watch out whether it's measured from the grade level, sight level, or level 1. So even though these are all at 7, Notice that some of them are above sight and some are below one. So that's okay. That's easy to fix. We'll go through. In fact, let me kind of show you a really kind of quick trick that'll fix that. Because I can choose that and say, let's make that off level one, that, okay. But if I drag through the whole model, it's going to sound really strange, and you select everything, then filter it so I'm only grabbing the windows. Okay, and I have all your windows. And it's going to make them all be based off of first floor. And all that's going to do is, yeah, raise them all up really quickly and make them all even on the bottom.
That might have moved one window. That is, like, I have two of the the large ones and then one above, so I don't know if that would have moved.
Well, we'll check it out too. Okay, so on this side, this is looking pretty good. If we wanted to go through and think about a combination of like a fixed window with a little transom window on top, let's think about that. We could take this fixed window and let's say we're going to put like a 2 foot transom window, 24 inches, so we'll lower this one so instead of being 6 feet tall, it'll be 4 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we'll go, let's try this, we'll see if we make it work. Let's go 36 by 48. Okay, and now we're going to go through and try and put some little 2 foot transom window above it. So we'll say, great, let's go out there. Oops, window. Like, and what was it in the other way? Is it 3 feet the other direction? That's too big.
Oh, and so you should know, I'm sorry, I do have to leave in a few minutes.
Nice.
So, yeah.
No worries. Okay, let me align this. I'm just going to align the top of that to the top of that one, okay? And I could even align the side of that one to the side of that one. Oops, not quite. Maybe we'll figure it out. Let's just fix this real quick, and then we'll answer any other questions before you have to head out. So in terms of, we got those windows in there. It's a little hard, you might notice, to sort of line them up because our elevation's a little sideways relative to your 45-degree angle. So what you can do here is, I'm just going to give you a real quickie on the elevation. If I take an elevation and I actually put a new elevation in that's actually just parallel to that, or parallel to the surface, okay. I'll have another one. Maybe I don't want to, you know, kind of show it as my primary elevation, but that's going to be a useful one. Oops, looks like I got the wrong side. We can just as easily have one that's parallel to this side. This guy. That's actually following the curve right now. There we go. And now this might make it a little bit easier to align this whole thing. So I got this window, I can align either the outside edge.
So it's better to do this in the elevation views rather than the 3D?
It's often, you'll get a little more precision in the elevation view.
Okay.
Okay, so not too bad there. Okay, so give me any last questions before you have to run out, because we can sort of definitely go through and do something like that with transoms over. You can play lots of games there. But so,
okay.
Is there something funky that's not quite working there? What do you think?
Well,
I'm thinking it's looking pretty darn good.
Yeah, I like how it's looking. Uh-huh. One thing about the toilet, I just wanted to make sure I use the right.
Let's take a look at it. Any and all questions are fair. This is a wall-hung toilet. Okay, that's fine. There's different toilets. There's a residential toilet, which is sort of more mounted to the floor and kind of drains the floor. This drains through the wall. This is actually probably closer to the one we have, like in our building. In commercial buildings, we tend to have this kind of toilet.
And the difference between like 15-inch seat height, 19-inch.
Now that's an interesting one because that's an easy one to fix even. But the difference is this is an ADA thing. 15 inches is kind of the standard toilet. Most toilets in your home is like 15 inches. Commercial toilet is 19 inches tall, so they're a little higher flying, and you may not notice it, but every once in a while you do because where it hits your knees and all that. So it's to be an ADA toilet, 19 inches is more proper.
Mm.
Yes, it's based on the seat height.
Yeah, I couldn't think about like where people better to have 15 or 19.
It's
so
they're quite fussy about heights and grab bars and all these different things about how to make it just the easiest to address.
Great.
Any other random ones?
No, that answered everything.
Great. I think you're looking great in terms of your sheets. Got a nice, okay, you're gonna put those on there. You're getting ready to do that.
Yeah, because I still want to add more dimensions.
No worries, but I think your model, your plan, that's looking good. I like these 3D views. You're gonna be able to drag those onto sheets. That's just me on my screen there. I think you're in great shape.
Yay.
Okay, so looking good. Let me go ahead and save this.
And I'll be back in like half an hour, so at
okay.
the end I can ask
you can grab
some
it at that
questions.
Point. Okay, grab some more. Super.
Great,
okay.
Thank you
no
so
worries.
Much.
Mr. Amir, let's talk about the questions you have or where you are in the process. See if we can sort of.
I just found out about dimensions. Now I'm working on that.
You've got dimensions?
Yeah.
Very good at adding to there. Very good. How about this? Let's go ahead. Can I borrow your model? Because I will show
sure.
the thing about how to create the, like that rounded counter. Because that's actually good. If you can, let me give you the thumb drive. And if you can, let's just go ahead and save it to the thumb drive. Because I think, yeah, that roundness in the counter, and even the little curtain wall, you got a lot of little things in your model I think are good things to show. Doing that, I'm going to do a little save as is yours, just to save it on the desktop so I don't lose anything. Okay, thank you, sir. Take you later. Later. What do we got here? Start. I just want to talk about that round countertop and how you create things like that, because that's sort of a good general principle for, yeah, some people will hit it here when they have rounded walls, some people do it in the vacation house because you'll need to put counters in or something like that. Okay, but let's just kind of show your model in general, just kind of give people a sense of what we're up to. So, we have these two parts of the building. Notice we got the big rounded surface there, which is actually really cool. We have some plants floating around out there on the outside. These are placed, actually it's interesting, they're a little high flying right now. Check that out. We put in some RPC plants because we thought that would kind of soften things up a little bit. Looks like they're kind of hanging out probably at level one right now, first floor. I just put them down on the site level. Okay, it just drops it down a little. Here's my plant. Looks like I might have grabbed your slab and I put it down on the side level. And that I didn't want it, that was a mistake. I'll put it back up to first floor. Okay, beautiful. So let's take a look. Actually, just for people who haven't seen this yet, This is being shown in what's considered a realistic view, just another view style. We're going to talk about that a lot more on assignment two when you render things, but often you're looking things as a shaded style, and you see the plants are kind of funny looking there, just like the outlines of them. You turn on realistic, it'll try to render them. It'll also try to render the materials. You might notice that, for the siding, for the wood grain, that's all kind of showing in a pseudo-realistic way. Not quite as good as doing a full rendering. Even the roof shingles are kind of looking fairly realistic. Just kind of comment, as long as I'm looking in there, just at one more choice. In these choices, there's always wireframe, which is kind of everything is transparent. We see only the edges. Hidden line, it hides the lines with no color. Consistent color and shaded, that's where it gets a little confusing for some people. The difference is really whether you include the effect of the sun on the coloration. So let me see if I can clear that and get out of here. Okay, what happens is, if you notice particularly on this like corner right here, which is away from the way the sun is shining right now, or appears to be shining, it's a little darker. If I say consistent colors, everything's even. So shaded just tries to include the effect of the lighting. And you have darker and lighter sides. Okay. Realistic is this one. That's the one where it tries to show the materials. Okay. It doesn't actually do a very good job with sun and shadows, but it does show the materials that are assigned there a little bit. And the final one, just so you sort of know, the whole array is ray trace. And ray trace does this. It won't let you edit, but it will go through and kind of do a more realistic material rendering. So let's see if it'll kick in here and do it for us. It's kind of thinking right now. Okay, so this is the more natural appearance of the materials. It's still a fairly low quality rendering right now. You sort of see the shadow on that side. You can sort of see the building over here. What will happen is when I stop moving, it'll try to retrace it a little bit finer. Even here, I can zoom in a little bit further. And it'll ray trace it even finer. So it just keeps on rendering it to the point where it's actually doing a fairly detailed job of rendering the materials and what they're gonna look like. Okay, but for the most part, as I'm working, I'll typically work in realistic or like shaded, one of those two. See, similar, but there's a difference in terms of the rendering's a little bit better in the ray tracing view. Okay, so let's take a look at just a couple things there. You're adding dimensions now.
This is not the updated version.
Oh, this is an older version. No worries. Okay, you'll add those, but in general, let's take a look at some things going on. In terms of the restroom, again, this is looking very fine in terms of the sinks and all that type stuff. Just a comment for you here in terms of working with them. This is sort of a sink which is typically put on top of a countertop. It's a sink that's missing its counter. Another sink that you can use that is typically used in an ADA scenario is a little bit different. Let's show you what it looks like. It's also, I think, in the loaded collection of things in here. Sink lab, sink vanity round, sink wall. That's sink wall oval, sink wall rectangular. Usually use that one. It's a wall sink. It just looks a little bit different. It has almost like a big china fixture with a basin built right into it. So it just mounts directly to the wall. So that's another one. You'll find that, for example, if you check out the restrooms around here, in the ADA compliant ones, they often use that because what they want to do, or they'll have a countertop that has no base cabinet because you want to be able to wheel your wheelchair right up and be able to get under the sink. Okay, so in these single restrooms on the first floor, it'll have more like, you'd see it's just this porcelain sink or china sink sitting right out. Upstairs in the multi-user restrooms, they have more of these type of sinks built into a countertop. Okay, but they're both available. You just have to make sure you provide clear space underneath. Okay, super. Okay, so for your dimensions, there's all these things in terms of the linear dimensions we've been showing. The radial dimension or the diameter dimension is good for that one. Click away. Oh, a radial dimension might be good for this. This is kind of always an interesting wall to dimension. Because here's the funny thing about this mall in terms of thinking about it. If you think about someone who's trying to estimate, you can say, would they be more interested in, well, that's probably helpful there. Okay, the radius of that. They could also think of that being more of an arc dimension, which is you choose the arc, and then you sort of choose one end of it, and another end of it, and then pull away. So you can think about what's useful to people. It kind of depends what you're up to, whether you're estimating, if you need to know the amount of wall surface, it's about 6'6". If you're laying it out, you want to know what that 4-foot radius is so that you could swing a line and try to figure out exactly where that lays out. Okay, but because you have these circles, that's what I wanted to talk about with people, because it's sort of a model is interesting that way. There was a wall here, and when we originally drew it, it was more just like a generic wall or something like that, but I kind of liked it. It was a really kind of groovy wall. So we started thinking about how to change that. I suggested that we might change it to a glass wall. So let's talk about what the difference is there. As you change it, if you change things to the default curtain wall type, what tends to happen is it creates a single line of glass because the glass doesn't understand that it can break every once in a while. So we changed the definition of curtain wall for you to change it around so that it allowed that there could be glass panels breaking every 3 feet. That's kind of fine. So now it's just a big glass wall that has just kind of breaks in there. So what it look like here. Let me rotate that around. Okay. Currently it's just glass panels. It doesn't have any mullions. It doesn't have any framing on it. If we wanted to add a little bit of framing to it, just to kind of separate that, let's go ahead and we'll take that wall, and it's really a property of the type of wall. And we can say, let's put some mullions on it. Mullions are the little dividers, the little metal frames that kind of hold it up and keep it, supported nicely. So I can put in, the standard ones are like this rectangular mullion. The way it works is there's the interior, then the edges. I'm going to put them on all the different surfaces. And all that's doing is it's putting that little bit of metal framing around there to support that. Now, that's a choice architecturally. Some people like that metal frame. Some people don't want to see that metal frame. They just really want to see glass and be, they usually can still put some sealant in there, but they just want it to look very clear and unobstructed. And we can do something like that too. If we wanted to, for example, have the metal frame around the edges but not have these interior metal pieces, what we would say is that's on the curtain wall right here. We'll take a look at the verticals, and on interior, we'll just say none. But we'll leave the ones on the edges. So now it's sort of supported around the edges to kind of keep it from moving. But it's just kind of a nice glass panel through there. That's actually a really nice even design feature, because if you think about people coming in from the outside and not really being heated or cooled, it could be nice that when the warm or cool air comes in through the door, the people who are back here working aren't disturbed. They don't sort of get that blast of air. So let's talk about some things going on back over here. Yeah, these windows are all nice casement windows, so those will swing open. We can catch breezes when we want to. That's fine. What we worked on yesterday, what I wanted to share with people, was this notion right here, this funny kind of piece of countertop, because a lot of times we need to go through and create a custom counter or a custom shape, and there's no Revit library part that works very well, so you need to create your own shape. And it's actually pretty easy to do. It's really the way that the Revit shapes are ultimately created. Underneath it all. But what we can do is something like this. I'll just sort of recreate this, sort of as though we were starting from scratch. We have our rounded wall, and again, there's gonna be no Revit part that'll probably fit that very custom shape. So we'll say, let's go through and make a component, but not let's place a component. Instead, we'll make a new one. We'll model one in place. So we'll choose that. This puts us into a sort of a special mode. In this mode, we're going to create this new part. We're going to make it out of several different elements. We're going to put them all together. So it could be a flat surface, it could be some legs, it could be a backsplash, it could be all sorts of things. But One thing we'll do is we'll assign a family to the whole element, this whole custom component. We need to assign the family. That'll determine what category it lives in. So if we turn things on or off, you know, or highlight things, it'll determine, you know, whether or not they show. So let's go ahead and just make it a piece of furniture. It'll live in the furniture world. Okay. We can call this, oh, give it a name. And now you might notice the mode actually changed a little bit. We are in a mode where most of the model is showing up in gray and there's this finish and cancel. So we're in sort of a special sub mode. And you have to watch out for that because it sometimes confuses things. You can't do other things. You're sort of stuck doing this. Now, in this mode, we can create a series of different extrusions, blends, revolves, sweeps. There's all these different forms we can put together in there. Yeah, I'm just going to show how some of them work. So for example, the most common one we use is the extrusion. The extrusion is really just, let's draw a profile. We'll draw some profile or series of lines down the ground and then just kind of raise up to a specific thickness. So for drawing those lines, what we showed is that you could go through and draw straight lines. Okay. Or what's very good, since you already have some lines you want to follow, we're going to use the pick line. And I'm just going to pick that surface right there. So that's easier than trying to draw a radius and make that happen. Now for the inner radius, you know, the depth of the counter in the other direction, I could go ahead and again try to draw a radius, but the easiest thing is to sort of use this pick and put an offset in. And the offset will really just measure that same line. It lets you pick the line, but puts an interior line that's some set distance across. Okay. Now we can go through and sort of just finish our profile. The idea is, oh, all the pink line rules apply. So anything that we usually do with pink lines, we have to create a closed surface, applies here. So watch out, this still has the offset, so it'll mess up my drawing. I'm gonna set that to zero. If I wanna finish that off like this, I can. What we did yesterday was we actually drew down here and made it square out here, but I'm gonna do something a little bit different with you today, just to kind of shake it up. I'm going to say, let's go ahead and pull a line here, pull a line over there, okay, and then I'll cut back 2 feet here, and I can do all sorts of things there back in that corner. In fact, I'm not sure I really like this shape so much. Let me come over here, I could offset this 2 feet over here. You can come up with really any shape you want. Now, back in the corner, if I wanted that to be sort of a rounded corner in here, there was this thing about the radius corners. We use that to actually make this wall down, the rounded wall of the bathroom. I can say, let's round this one to that one and kind of create something really groovy. So that's kind of nice. We can say, oh, out here on the end of this, maybe I don't want a straight line there. Maybe what I would like is just an arc. But the idea is this just gives you the ability to kind of create really anything you want. Now, as we're creating it, let me modify and get rid of that extra line in there. Maybe I can't. Is that line really there or not? That's just a leftover. Okay. Let me finish that. Or actually, let me not quite finish it yet. There's two other settings that I want you to sort of think about. One is sort of the extrusion start and end. I guess that's two, really. That's really the height of the bottom of the extrusion, the height of the top of the extrusion. So, oh, what did we figure out? This desk is, I thought it was 30, I think it's actually 28 inches. I don't remember what high desks are. If it's 28 inches, we'll let that be the top. Okay. On the bottom over here, I'm going to make it less, 2 inches less, so maybe 2'2". Apply that. Oh, one other thing we want to do. I want to change the material, you know. Hey, by default it's going to be this gray material, but the gray is not necessarily going to be very interesting, so I can choose a material here. See what I have. I'm going to make it like oak. That looks pretty good. We're going to talk a lot about more material, about a lot more about materials in assignments 2 and 3. But great, we're ready to finish this. So if you went out and looked at it now, You see, it's kind of hanging around out there. Not too awfully bad. Notice we're still in a special mode, though, because we're in a mode where we have the primary, we're still editing this piece of furniture. We've put one element in, but we can add some more elements to it. For example, we might want to put some legs under this, something like that. So here's how that would work. My first piece is already there. Let me say we're going to create another piece to it. And for legs, we could go a lot of different ways. If I wanted little circular legs, that's probably a pretty good assumption. I could take little circles. Say I'll make it big first. That's a little bit large. So I'll go back and say that you are, as a radius, maybe 2 inches, like a 4-inch diameter leg. Okay, that looks pretty good. The cool thing about these pink line rules is we can actually make multiple segments if we want to. So if I want to do a whole bunch of legs, what I can do is say, okay, I like you so much, I'm going to copy you over to the center over here. I'm going to copy it over to, I'll probably need one somewhere about there. I'll probably need someone about here. Okay, just a little more support for that thing. Now, since these are all the same extrusion, the material I give to these and the height I give to them will be the same for all four of them or all five of them. Okay, so that's actually pretty good. I can say that I want it to go from 0 to 2'2". Okay, and for the material, what do we have in mind? What would look good for legs? We can try and find some aluminum or some steel or something like that. Let's see what I have out here. Do I have any aluminum? Anodized blue, anodized bronze, metal, steel, metal, aluminum. Yeah, something right there. Great. Finish that up. Okay. So now I have two pieces of this. I could add other pieces. I could add a backsplash. Oh. It's kind of interesting about this whole sort of thing. If you want to cut a hole in it, not that you necessarily do, but if you wanted to go through and put a hole in this, you could go through and either kind of cut a notch in there, or even if I just cut a hole, that's not a very sensible hole. It'll cut out a hole in the middle. So you can really just completely customize this however you want it to be. And what we're doing here for this individual piece, which is so custom to here, seems like that's a lot of work, but if we wanted to actually make this a repurposable piece that we could use in many different projects, we would do a very similar thing, but we'd create a family as opposed to just this custom component. But let's check it out. I think you're actually looking pretty good. So super. Okay, you're looking good. I think you're ready for some desk chairs, so we can go through. Let's see what we have in here. Here's a trick. I never used to use this, but people have shown me it, so let me show you the same thing. Usually I pull down this menu and you'll find me going up and down trying to find the thing I want, and it takes a long time. And there's actually a search there. I never really think about that. But so if you just type chair, you'll find out what chairs are available. Who knew? So I can get like a task chair with arms, like the ones we have here. Okay, as I'm putting it in here, I can drop it in. If you hit the space bar, it'll rotate through a couple of orientations. But maybe I'll put one over here, kind of in there. Maybe one over here. It's interesting, over here we could have one on the opposite side, like you're sort of sitting there having a meeting. Okay, now I'll rotate. If I'm rotating, I could go through and hit that tool. Another thing I want to let you know about, though, is there's these shortcuts, like RO for rotate. So if you use that, RO, it turns on the tool, and I can say, instead of facing this way, I want you to face more that way. Here, I think I need to RO that one. What I usually do is pick sort of where it does face and kind of change it to where I want it to face. RO here, good. This is getting pretty interesting in terms of like how customizable you can do it. If you wanted to, you don't need to do it for the purposes of what we do, but then if you go out, you'll find computers, you'll find all sorts of stuff kind of hanging around up there to really flesh it out. For this assignment, it's really more about just understanding the size and scale. Like, you know, you sort of want to understand that really, you know, two or three people could work around that desk. In assignments two and three, especially in three, we'll talk about why it might be nice to do some things like, you know, put some computers on the desk, or put a picture on the wall, do different things to kind of make it even more visual in terms of understanding what it is. Okay, let's see what else is going on out here. That might be good things to show. Your restroom, again, I think it's looking good there. Your storeroom is fine. Oh, in terms of this area back over here, this is our storeroom. Let's go to our workroom. This is one where right now it's just the countertop. If you want to, you can stretch the countertop and make it the whole length if you want to. Again, I'll say, with all the things I give you like this, where I say, oh, put an 8-foot countertop in there or something like that, that's really kind of a minimum in terms of, you know, what it would be. But it's always okay to exceed that and really design it the way you think it should be, because that's such a nice room, I might as well just go ahead and make it a little bit larger. I'm going to show you a couple things here in terms of fixing that up. You'll notice that the lines are so fat right now, it's actually sort of hard to tell where the edges are very precisely. And that is this notion of there's a thick and a thin line mode. The fat lines are an indication of how it will be when it prints. If you plot it out and you send it to your printer, the lines will come out fat like that. If you want to see things in thin lines, which will just give you more precision as you're placing things, I could turn this little widget on. Tool switch to thin line, so that's just it'll switch it down so we can see a little bit better. It just makes all the lines thin, so I have a better chance of seeing exactly where that wants to be. Now I'm trying to pull this to make it hit the wall, but I'm having a little bit of trouble making it hit the wall precisely, so I'm going to use the align tool, because the align tool will help me make that happen precisely. I'll say go to the align tool, which is AL. Like a type AL, and it always works. You click the line, the point of alignment you want to pull things towards, and then you pull the thing to it. And if you want it to lock to it, the effect of that being if the wall moved, the counter would stretch, you can lock that to it. That'd be fine. Super. We could do the same thing over on the other side. There, I think we actually landed pretty good just by approximating with our eye. Well, let's take a look. Not quite. I'll align this to the edge there. Oh, that's interesting. Okay. So I got that thing hanging around there. Now, for our purposes, we didn't say anything about putting cabinets in. You don't really have to put cabinets in for assignment one. In assignments two and three, though, you might want to think about putting some cabinets in, just to kind of flesh things out. Ah, here's an interesting one. We got a little bit of a difference if that does stretch out in terms of the windows. So if that does start to make a difference, we could make these windows shorter, just so they don't block. Okay, or I could pull that cabinet back. That'd be good to do. Let's talk about cabinets, though, ever so briefly. Ah, even over here, what is this? This is a countertop, okay, like that. You have another one that has a hole in it, okay, which might be good for your sinkhole. Okay, if you use this one, what you can do is, again, pull that as far as you want. I'm not going to pull it to the window just because now that I know the window's there, I don't want to interfere with the window. But then I got that sinkhole there. What I can do is, if I can get the sinkhole, looks like I'm moving the sinkhole. Try to line that up. Now, this is another case where just based on the types of sinks, this is more of a, this is like the sink that goes into the like the bathroom. Okay, so if you want to put more like a lab sink or a kitchen sink in there, not to worry. Let's see if I can find one of those. There's this lab sink, they call that. There's a double kitchen sink. I'll do the lab sink. Okay, what's going to complain about? This is like what's called a wall hosted sink, and the lab sink doesn't need a host. So I'm going to take that one out and just put in. I should use the trick. Sinks, let's see if I got available to myself. Pedestal sink, sink lab. It looks like that lines up pretty well.
Yeah, part.
I want this sink to actually have handles on it. I think there's another one that actually does have handles on it to make it let us make it smaller. But I'll leave it like that for now. It's a reasonable approximation. Okay. As you're thinking about your cabinets, though, let's talk about things you can do. Because in cabinets, in the world of cabinets, there's a lot of things you can do to sort of like easily make them look more detailed. So for example, here we have a countertop. That's cool, and it has the sink in it, but it's also open underneath. If you think you want to put some cabinets under there, okay, we can do that. And we can do it a couple of different ways. Super. Okay. If we want to go through and just really quickly create the illusion of cabinetry, but not really spend much time detailing it, okay, so really just block out the space where the cabinet will be, but not really take the time to model it in detail, we could go back and use the model in place. And we'll make a piece of cabinets usually called casework. Okay, lab bench cabinets. So very often, if I'm just working really quickly and I don't have time, in fact, we were working on a project. You know, Hanku is here with us today. Yeah, we were doing that. We modeled a kitchen. We didn't spend the time to put all the cabinets in. We just sort of drew the shape of the cabinets and said, okay, that's a starting point. So how you can do that is just draw a rectangle. Usually cabinets are 2 feet deep, so I will dimension that so it's 2 feet deep. Say super. In terms of the cabinets themselves, as far as the height goes, usually what happens is we'll go from zero to the proper dimension. If you're going to go really quickly and you didn't even put a countertop, it'd be to 3 feet. Because 3 feet is typically the top. If you have the countertop there and you want to leave a little space, make it to 2'10½". Because usually the countertop's 1.5 inches thick. Okay, super. And we can make that again oak or whatever we want it to be. Oops, cancel here. Let's see what I got over here. I think I have it over here. Oh, it's wood oak. Without the dash. There it is. Okay, and finish that up. So at a really high level, yeah, it's kind of cheap, but it'll work. Actually, let me comment about what's happening with the oak. Why is my oak so gray? I'll tell you what that is. We'll go back into the materials. I can manage this a number of different ways. I'll go to the materials. And I'll say, let's look at our wood oak. The appearance is kind of this. The graphics right now is currently showing is that sort of gray color. If you'd like it to have more the golden color, like the wood, you can say turn on the rendering appearance and it'll give you like a brown color. What it does is, as it does that, it tries to figure out what the background color is in this image and kind of use that as the color here. So you could use that. Or if you wanted to make your own color, you could click on this and say, oh, I want it to be a very light gray or light brown, something like that. Okay, so that is what I would call doing a sort of very quick and dirty representation of the cabinets. then at least you know where you're not supposed to put your feet. You sort of can see where the storage is going to be. Okay, at least volumetrically. But there's an easy way to do it also if you would rather do the detail of the cabinets. And usually what I'll do is, after I sort of figure out where the cabinets belong, then I'll go through the time after that's sort of stabilized and put the detailed cabinets in. But not necessarily right away, because if the client and you are still moving around the cabinets quite a bit and you haven't decided, putting in cabinets involves a little bit of detailed work, so you may be getting ahead of yourself. So, you know, sometimes it's volumetrically you can figure it out and then go back and add the detail. Okay, so for more detailed cabinets, here's what you do. So we say, great, let's go ahead and that's my casework. There's my lab bench cabinets. I'm just going to even shrink that up so that I'll just keep it over here for now. Okay. If I want to put some real cabinets in, I'll go to Architecture and say Components. And let's take a look at what we have in here. A little cabinet search. You'll see I have some base cabinets that have two doors and a drawer. I have a single door and a drawer. There's different sizes and widths. Upper cabinets if I want to put some things on the wall. So, for example, a really good starting point, a very common size cabinet is around 36 inches wide, two doors and a drawer. You can go ahead and put it in. I always have to remember about which way is which in terms of, let me tab it so that it goes this way. I think that's the back of it, but again, I'll put it in wrong, then I'll fix it because it might be backwards. And then I'll put another one right next to it over here. Okay, let's just take a look in 3D. Okay, that's not looking bad at all. If you want to put some wall cabinets in there, that's just about the same sort of operation. You'll say components, place a component, and I'll put, look for wall cabinets instead. Upper cabinet, double wall. I'll just go ahead and put that on this. Beautiful. So that's a little more realistic. So you sort of see everything from, nothing, okay, which is the first. If I have 5 minutes and I just have to put a counter in, I'll do it that way. If I have 10 minutes, I'll go through and put the box in. And if I have 20 minutes, then I'll go through and put the cabinets in and kind of show it in a little more detail. Okay, but for anyone watching, just putting in the counters is sufficient. But as we go forward, and especially as you start thinking about assignment 2 and 3 and you try to create more realistic renderings, you'll get more into either putting in those boxes or putting in the real detailed components.
So if we're to the assignments, then 3D, we will work on the same model? Or?
Actually, you'll do a slightly different model. We're going to do a model of a vacation house. So we can take a look at that next, but how about first, let's finish up with questions. Yeah, I've been rattling on about things that I thought were interesting, but what are questions you have now still? Or
is there any way to do those dimensions automatically?
Well, there are sort of, but let's take a look at it, because it does do some of that stuff. Bianca found it. Let's kind of see what we have, in terms of doing this. I just got to find where it lives. Ah, it's actually right here. Well, hang on. I'm going to say that I'm going to prefer the faces of the core. Let me say entire walls and turn on options. Okay, so, let me show you how this works. If I say to do the individual references, that's where I'm picking 1, 2, 3. It's like what I usually do. I usually go over here, I click over here, and I place that individually. Okay, the auto wall dimensions, which is actually a pretty good starting point for what you want to do, is we'll pick an entire wall. And if you pick the entire wall, you get to choose how much detail you want. So let's see what it does by default. By default, if I pick that entire wall, okay, that's just giving me the overall dimension. Okay, let me try it out of the wall. If I just pick this wall, it gives me the overall dimension there. So that's okay, that's a starting point. But let's try this other one. We'll say aligned and options. And we'll say, let's do the intersecting walls. Let's do the openings. Okay, so this actually gives us more of the way I typically do it. It's the overall, the intersecting walls, and finally the openings. So if I say okay to this, let's see what happens. That's interesting. It's a whole bunch right on top of each other. Let's see what this looks like. That doesn't look right to me. It's the faces of the core. It's doing the openings. I wanted to do multiple layers. That's the entire wall right here. If I was looking at this, I would say the part that's a little odd is these ones right here. So I would go back in and I would remove that witness line and I'd remove this one. Okay, but again, that's not giving me exactly what I want. Let me pop back out again. Let's see if we, because you know, Bianca's looks so good. Let's see how we can do this again. If I say an radius arc dimension, just do it to the wall faces. Faces of the core here. It's interesting now. I think I have to go through and do those. I'll put that back on. I think I have to select them individually. So if she found a completely automatic way to do it, that could be a new one for us in terms of understanding that. Because I don't think of that as being automatic. I think I have to go through and basically click these center lines of the windows. Something like that. So I don't know about that. Dimension, let's see if we can find anything else in here. Spot elevation types? That's just the types. It's just really the aligned dimensions. It has that option, but it's pick entire walls. No. When Bianca comes back, let's ask her sort of what her secret is, because I think she's found another thing that's an interesting way of doing it. Okay, so what other things can we try? Dimensions are definitely kind of a little muckier. The tagging, that one's pretty easy. That one's the one that's very automatic. When we say annotate and you say that you want to tag, you can tag individually or you can say tag all. And then you can say, let's get all the windows at once. That's a real quickie. Oh, actually, it's interesting. Because this tag ended up on the inside, that actually is pointing out that window. That's okay. Like, we all flip windows.
Yeah, I had changed it in my model, but it's the older one.
No worries. These are just little things that sort of clue you in. And then over here, the nice thing is we do know that, like, since they're all the same window, if you change the designation on one of them, it'll change them on all of them. Okay, so looking pretty good in terms of what's going on. Make sense?
Yeah, sure.
Okay,
thanks.
So no worries. So this one, I think you're actually in really good shape in terms of finishing up this. Let's go ahead, let's take a look at assignment two briefly, just so you sort of get a sense of what's going on there. Because two and three actually work together. But let's just sort of see if we can start to answer some questions about that. So let me go over to the assignments. Let's take a look at the description of it. The idea for this one is it's a little bit different. It's a vacation house. What we're going to do is is it goes a starting point, which is a little bit of a hill, and then there's a brief that just kind of talks about it. Let's just kind of read what it's supposed to do first. That is, you want to build a vacation house that really, it's going to be a place that you and your friends are going to go up and kind of use on the weekend. So you're not going to live there day in and day out. You're just going to go there on the weekend and have a good time. So in terms of thinking about it, it's not really, it's a little bit different. It's really more about an entertaining space, a comfortable place for you to hang out. You know, there'll be a kitchen slash food preparation area, but not in the traditional sense where someone's going to be cooking in there every night. It's more like a space where you may prepare a nice group meal together, but you may just, you know, get pizza some nights or get some take-in food or something like that, and kind of just, you know, live there. But overall, you're going to build this little vacation house, about somewhere between 1,800 and 2,200 square feet, kind of a big central space. That's where I think most people spend their time, just hanging out. Maybe there's a fireplace there. You can think about that. Some sort of food preparation. Okay, so again, not necessarily a traditional working kitchen, but it has to have, you know, just a basic space that would support, you know, you probably don't have a huge pantry as much as you have, just kind of maybe some nice countertops so people can sit and visit with you when you're kind of cooking and kind of preparing food. Okay, some sleeping spaces. Okay, so two bedrooms around 12 by 12, you know, could be larger, something like that. Think of one as having like a queen size bed, another being a double bed plus typical bedroom furniture, or the other could probably be twin or bunk beds or single beds plus other furniture. There's two bedrooms, something like that. Chances are the lucky people will get the bedrooms, the other people are sleeping on the couches in the living room, something like that. Some bathrooms. Again, you want to have a shower, a sink, a toilet, things like that, but it doesn't have to be a very grand bathroom, like a big house, just enough to kind of be very functional when students are coming. Okay. In addition to the main room, I like the idea of there being some sort of what I call a quiet room or a study, which is a space where if you just happen to have to do some homework or something like that, and you still want to be connected, but you wanted to have a little bit of privacy and a little bit of quiet, you can sort of get away just a little bit from what's going on in the main space. So you can also think of it as being a pot, a guest room at times. It might have a sofa, a futon, or some sort of bed that people could sleep in there too. Okay, but the idea is that it's, in addition to the big living room, a separate space where if you needed to kind of just work quietly and you didn't want to be disturbed, and you didn't want to disturb anyone because you're taking a phone call or whatever, you go there. Okay. Some storage space, because you're going to want some space to keep, just, you know, different recreational equipment, things you might need. And a parking area. Now the parking area doesn't have to be a full garage, but it's kind of space for two cars. So that could be just a parking space that has like a canopy over it of some type, like a carport, or it could be a garage. Okay, but as you're thinking about this, this 400 square feet for the garage, you don't have to count that against the 2,000 square feet. It's kind of its own separate thing. Okay, so you've got this hillside side, good views of the lake and the valley below. Okay, and the student here, they would like some outdoor entertaining space, so think about a deck or a terrace so you can take advantage of the view. Okay, the clients also gave you some images. These are images of houses they like, and these are all famous houses, so your house probably won't look exactly like these, but these are they're kind of giving you a sense of the style they like. Yeah, so this is Falling Water, okay, in Pennsylvania. And you see there's a lot of glass, there's balconies, there's stone, it's kind of very connected to nature. This is actually the Farnsworth House, that's in Illinois. That house is, it's a little more modern, it's all steel, raised up above the ground a little bit, but you can sort of see it's pretty open, very glassy. Again, yeah, this is not a very fussy space, this is a very modern, very clean sort of space. Okay. This is actually called a curtain house. In Japan, but again, it's very clean, open, dramatic. You know, it's got a sort of a size and a shape. It's kind of interesting. So think of these as being sort of like, you know, just ideas to kind of get you thinking. There's some information here about how you might build it. You know, this wood frame, it's probably a two-story structure. One thing that's interesting is the issue of building below grade, so we'll talk about that a little bit, because I think that's going to be the one that usually gets most people. Yeah, just kind of having to think of things about a little bit different. So we'll look at that in the model. But in the end, what you're going to do is you're going to do a model that has walls, doors, windows. You're going to do some floor plans and some elevations, things like that. Yeah, in there you'll have stairs. You know, depending on what number of units people are taking it for, typically we'll go through and put in the fixtures, some furniture, some of the cabinetry. Okay, and we'll talk about those views highlighting furniture or plumbing elements. But what's going to happen is this model, this very same model that you're using here, you'll go through and use to render. So you go through and put materials and sun and shading and kind of like think about that. So this model we will carry through for two assignments. Okay, so that's kind of the gist of it, but let's kind of take a look at what we got started with. So out there, on the file server, you'll actually find, let me see if we can go out there to where it is. What do I gotta do? I gotta go over to A, I think it is. There's a starting point. It's a very old version of it. Should probably do the newer version. Okay, so if you open that, all that you really have in that file so far is a hillside. So that's going to show you what that looks like. I'm going to cancel that for right now. And it's going to open the one that I just downloaded from the file server, or from the coursework site. What usually happens is somewhere along the ways I often clean things up, so you want the newest version. Okay. So I'll go to, hang on. Where'd it go? There it is. Okay, this version. And as it's uploading, let's talk about what you're going to find and how you have to deal with it. Now, in the file, there are a lot of wall types and window types and things that I think might be useful to you, furniture types and things like that. You can always pull in some more. But there's some of those things in the starting point file. The other thing that's there is a hillside. And let's just talk about the hillside, because the hillside is always an interesting thing. The hill, if I was looking at it sideways, let's see if it opens up in the background there. I think it's going to come right now. Okay, so here's our hillside. Kind of right in there. So the funny thing about thinking about a hill like this is, just really how your house is going to sit on the hill. So there's different ways you can do that. For example, some people build houses and they do what I call, they'll build them on stilts. They'll build a house that's up here, okay, and then underneath it, its connection to the hillside will be all these sort of piers or stilts that just sort of hold it up so it's above the hillside. Okay, and that's kind of okay. Yeah, it's one way of doing it. We can even sort of think about bringing that down a little bit lower. Maybe the house is more down at this level. And we just have stilts under parts of it. Then it sort of just comes to the ground over here. Okay, and again, that's okay as a way to do it. An interesting way to think about houses, in terms of being on the hillside, is sometimes build them in a way that you cut into the hillside so that you have something that's partially underground and partially not. And an example of that would be, for example, if I cut into the ground like this and then came up, draw that like that, okay, I could go through and have a house that has a lower portion that's partially underground but actually on the front is above ground. So if I think about, oh, for example, building a terrace or something like that, I can sort of just be, you know, right on the ground and walk out to the ground. Okay. But what we'll often do if we have a multi-story house is we could go ahead and build right on top of here a second story. Okay, and that actually works. Sometimes in a house like this, what we'll do is we'll have a nice balcony that sticks out so that people can go out and enjoy the view of the hillside. Then we can think about the roof. Sometimes roofs look like this. Often on these sorts of hillside houses, though, it'll be something a little more dramatic. It'll look like that. It'll come down and kind of be a shed roof, kind of like you have. So you have big soaring ceilings and a lot of glass and all that kind of stuff. So a lot of ways to do this. Another way to think about this, though, is you could also build the house kind of step back a little bit. For example, you could build the house more like this. So what happens is the roof of this area actually becomes a terrace. Then the roof, whatever's happening here. So there's a lot of ways you can use the hillside. Okay. But generally, when you're working within Revit and you're working with the hillside, you can do all these things. That's kind of okay. The only thing you have to worry about is this part where you cut into the hillside, because you want to make sure that the earth doesn't fill up your house. Okay, so that's the first starting point in this in terms of where it gets a little bit different. The two things that I think are different about this assignment that, you know, sort of three things that are sort of, I think, interesting and challenging. One is the whole issue of the hillside and kind of cutting into it. The second is the issue of the first and second story walls and getting them to line up properly. And the third one is stairs. You have to put some sort of stairs in there to get between them all. So let's talk about them each. If I go to the lower level as a starting point, often what I will do is go through and draw some walls. And for these walls, if the lower level is going to think about cutting into the ground, okay, they'll often be made of concrete, because we don't want to put wood that will be rotting or have the weight of the soil pushing up against it. So in terms of wall types, I'll usually come over here. And for the wall types, I'll choose like a concrete wall. That's fine. They'll go from level lower level, I'll say, to upper level, so that height. Now, as I place the walls, though, I'm going to use a very special kind of location line. And as you draw walls, there's always this notion of, really, are you drawing them in the center? Are you drawing the outside face? As you draw a single line, where does the thickness of the wall go? Okay. And I'm going to recommend, as opposed to center line, which is where it usually comes by default, that we switch that. I'm going to say that the best place is, it's actually going to be called the core face. The core face is really, it's the face of the structural material. So if our concrete wall, it's usually the face of the concrete. For a wood frame wall, it's usually the face of the wooden studs. Okay, for a like CMU wall, it'll be the face of the CMU where there's a finish on the outside of it. So I like the core face because when we think about aligning things from floor to floor, we usually align them so the structural core lines up and then the finish is on the outside. Okay, so how that works is like this. I'll go through and draw some sort of shape. So this is just a guess. I have no idea. But that's like sort of a guess of what the bottom shape might look like. And let's take a look at it in 3D. So here we are. You can see it's underground a little bit. We have some earth in there. So we are going to think now about this and how we really want to handle that earth. So typically what we do is, to get rid of the earth, we'll put in something called a building pad. And a building pad suppresses the earth. It's kind of like bringing in a scraper and kind of pulling the earth away. Okay? And we can pull it out from the middle here. We can have our pad just under the house. We could also have a pad that's outside a little bit if we want to have more of a patio or something like that that extends out from the house. So let's kind of take a look at both sort of scenarios. Let's say over here, here's the lower level. So I want to put, again, it's like a floor, but it's not quite a floor. It's going to be under the floor, just kind of moving away the earth. It's under massing and site. I say I want a building pad. Okay. In terms of the height, oh, I can go ahead and say that's going to be fine. I'm going to pull it about 6 inches below, because I want it to be below my floor. I'm going to choose some walls. I usually choose the outside of the walls, because I want the earth to be cut away so my concrete walls don't intersect with the earth. I want the earth to stop on the outside. So I'll say, great, I'm going to finish this. And the net effect of this so far is I now have this pad in there. Now, on top of this pad, I can go through and put a floor. Okay, usually the floor will just be to the inside. Okay. So I can say that I'll put a floor in here. We can choose what I want our floor to be. Oh, I'm gonna make it still a concrete slab, although I could put a concrete slab and I put some wood over it or something like that. Maybe I'll do that. I'll say a concrete slab. Then I'm gonna duplicate it. I'll say concrete slab plus wood floor. So I'll add another layer on top of that. Move it up. It's gonna be a finished layer. I'm gonna call it like wood floor or something like that. Anything? That's what I got. There's wood floor. Okay, give that a thickness of like an inch. Okay, so now I have a floor on top. I'm gonna make that to be on the inside because I don't want it to go to the outside of the concrete. Okay. I'll finish that up. So I got a nice wood floor, I got the pad underneath. We're doing pretty good. Okay. The front of the house here at this point, probably, I believe, is still just a little bit, actually it might be above grade there, but I think if I choose those walls, you can sort of see I'm still a little bit below grade. Okay. Now, for your purpose, if you want to sort of move the earth, that's okay. If you don't want it to be there, you can move the earth down or up. Yeah, or I can add another pad. So for example, if you want to say that, you know, hey, the earth is just going to be lower, feel free to just move the earth. That's okay. They have the right relationship you want to have with the earth. But what I'm going to do is add another pad, though, out front. Now, this pad thing I put out front is really going to be supporting the patio. So out here, you put the pad. I'm going to put it to the other side of the concrete. Here's the deal. Pads can't overlap with each other. It only has to be on one side. So since the pad came to the inside, or the inner, it came to that outside wall for that other pad, I just need to sort of make sure the two don't overlap with each other. So now I have two pads. I have the pad underneath the house, and I have the pad over here. Actually, the one under the house, it moved. Let me sort of, if I move it back again, just because. Let's see if I can get it. Add a tab. There it is. It moved because I moved the earth down. I moved the same, -0.6. So, I have my pad sticking out here. I have the earth, that's all good. Actually, even in here, for these things, I should basically take those walls and lower them down actually to the -6 inches too, just to be complete. That way there's no gap. Oh, hang on. I definitely goofed there. You. Are you there? You are there. Okay, good. Now, as you look at this, you'll see we're quite okay on the sides. We would probably need to put a little bit of a retaining wall over here, a retaining wall over there, just to kind of keep that up, but that's okay. We'll do that. Now, because this part here is actually now no longer underground, we could make that wood or we could make that windows. We could do things like that. So, for example, if we wanted to go through and split this, so I'll leave the concrete right up on the wall, and I'll leave the concrete right here just because we're going to have that little retaining wall here. But this whole center portion here, here, and here, that can be now a wooden wall, or that could be some combination of glass. So I can say, hey, let's go ahead and I'll do some wood siding in there. Or if I wanted to, I could split it out and make a little bit of a curtain wall or something like that. So I say that great for this lower area over here. Let me modify that. I'm gonna put some nice glass corner on this corner part of it right here. So I'll say that one, this one. I'll make it like a curtain wall. Okay, so you know, we can have fun in there in terms of really kind of doing that. But as long as we have the earth held back, we're good. Then we can make the inner part be whatever we want to. Now, we can put windows into the concrete. That's okay. Yeah, we can do that over there. But we have more freedom where the concrete is held back. Okay, so let me pause there, because that's really the whole issue of just the pad, kind of working around the pad. Okay, because the last thing we'll show, though, is really how we do the second floor relative to that. Going to sort of see how you feel about that building pad issue. Kind of okay, or you see to sort of experiment with it, or?
Thanks so much, Jeff.
All right.
And may I know when you upload this session?
I'll just upload it right now.
Okay.
Okay, great. So you're heading out plus?
Yeah.
Okay, no worries. I'm sorry to keep you waiting. No worries. Okay, so that's that. I will upload this file that we've been working on here so you can play with that too.
Great.
But this will be, it'll be up in half an hour or something like that. Okay, no worries. Okay, hopefully it'll get you started good.
Thanks so much.
I don't worry, for all these things. When you need to go, just tell me. That way you can go. Okay, let me do this. I'm gonna put it on my desktop and we'll put it up there. My computer, my desktop. Hey, go have a good afternoon.
You too, thanks. Goodbye.
Okay. Okay, let me do this. And then we'll meet in just a minute, Rami. Okay, this is going to be session 3, vacation. House example in class. Okay, I'll just finish this up for the video, just so that people who are watching it that way can sort of get this. In terms of what's happening, in terms of this lower wall being concrete and what's gonna happen in terms of the upper floor walls, the idea is if we sort to, all right, because we've gone ahead and placed the location wall carefully, we can get the walls to line up fairly nicely for us. Let's see if I can sort of demonstrate that and make it work. Although, that's flashing around a little. Okay, let's see how this works. Here's the idea. We have these walls over here. These walls over here are currently set up as concrete. That's fine, they go up to the upper level. That's kind of super. What I want to do is actually copy them to the upper level. They're on lower level now, I'm gonna copy the upper level. So what I'll do is, go ahead and just copy the walls gonna grab all of them. Just do a little tab action, get all the different walls. I'm gonna copy the clipboard, and I'm gonna paste them aligned to the upper level. So the good news about that is they actually are right around the upper level. They're kind of just exactly matching the walls below. That's a little bit easier to go through and copy and do it that way and get the perfect alignment as opposed to redrawing them again. Now, it's warning me they overlap a little, and they do a little down there. At the upper level, I still have that minus 6 inches. I'm gonna make that back to 0. Okay, so now they don't overlap anymore. So these are looking pretty good. Everything is perfectly aligned between the upper and lower level. Now, as you think about these upper level walls, a small kind of nuance that I want to draw to your attention that is important though in terms of getting them aligned properly is this whole issue of the location line. Because you might remember I'm aligning them or I'm drawing them based on the core face exterior, I've copied them on up. The reason I like that as my location line is if I change the wall type now, it'll hold that line constant. And what I'm gonna do is basically take that concrete wall and switch it over to like a wood siding wall. And what happens when I change that is it gets a little bit fatter, it kind of moves on out because it's a little bit thicker. But the important thing is it does it on the outside, it moves it out, it actually holds that line constant. Let me go ahead and see if I can demonstrate that in the floor plan view just to kind of really drive it home. So here we have the concrete wall. Okay. What I'm going to do just to really make it very clear is I'm going to put a detail line in here just to show you where things are so you can sort of see. So here's a line. That's a line that's the outer face of the concrete right now. And what I'm going to do is take that wall and switch it over to the siding wall. Okay, now notice what happened there. I'll go into detail. That line stayed in the same location. The studs are directly lined up over the concrete, but this outside surface, the siding and the wood sheathing right there, that's on the outside. And that's the right relationship you'd like it to have. So the whole issue of the location line and using the location line so that when the walls kind of get changed, they stay aligned, will really help you a lot. And I know that may seem a little abstract at first, but go ahead and try playing with it a little bit. It'll save you a lot of time in the long run if you make sure that happens. So for all these different walls, go through and make sure that, for example, it says the location line is core face exterior before you change them. We can always fix it after the fact, but it's better if you fix it right up front or get it lined up right. Now what's happening is if I go back to 3D, and there's one more little length of wall right here to fix. Let me fix that one. Change that over. Earrings joining up fine. Okay, so just be aware of that. That's actually one of the little ones that's kind of a subtle one that'll save you work in the long run if you sort of kind of just pay attention to it right up front. The last piece I want to show is just in terms of the floors, and then I'll let everyone go. As I think about putting the floor on the upper level, you might ask about sort of where to put it to, and it actually makes a little bit of a difference for what we're doing here. If I say that I want to put the floor in there, and I'll make a floor architectural, I'm going to choose the wood finish floor for my upper floor. Watch out for this setting right here, the extend the wall, the into the wall core, because it'll make a little bit of a difference. I'm going to actually turn it off and demonstrate what happens if you don't turn that on, just so you get a sense. I'll pick the walls. I'm going to pick the outside face of the walls. Do a little trimming. I need to do that. Okay, looks like that one's not on the outside. Hey, welcome back.
Hi.
We're just talking about the vacation house a little bit, but set yourself up and you can ask any questions. I was just playing around with this one, thinking about walls and the relationship and how the floor would work. They finish that.
For the vacation house?
Yes. Let me trim this. And I'll finish what I was saying, and then we'll take a look at any questions you're having here. Okay, so here's the deal. I just drew my floors in what I'll call the wrong way, or the way that gives me a little more trouble. And I wanted to do it this way just to sort of demonstrate what the impact is. And what we did was we drew the floor, but when we chose the floor, we said, just run it right to the exterior face of the walls. And what happens is, now that I have these multi-story walls, you can actually sort of see the floor bleeding through there a little bit. You even sort of see, oh, it looks a little bit funny. We sort of half see the floor, we don't half see the floor. And the reason is, it's really perfectly aligned with the concrete. It's not sure what to show you. So this is a case where like two things are overlapping sort of in the wrong place. You know, if we want this to happen, we can cut the concrete down below the floor. But what we actually want to do is actually move the floor back in a little bit. Because typically, we don't run the floors to the outside face of the wall. We run the floors to the stud face. So we kind of hold them back a little bit. So this was sort of the wrong way, but let's show you how we get it the right way. So I'm going to take that floor out.
And the studs end at the core? Or?
Yes. You're asking exactly the right question. So the idea is, if I go to the upper level, what I've done is I've put some stud walls on top of the lower floor concrete walls. Let me shade those just so you can sort of see. So this gray area is the stud wall right in there. And what's happening is we have the sheetrock on the inside, then we have these studs. Those are like, probably 2x6s or they're 2x6s here, so 5.5 inches thick. We have this yellow layer, which is the plywood, then we have some sort of siding on the outside. So you have these four layers. And what we tend to want to do is we want to line up the concrete walls below with the studs, because we like basically the siding to run outside of the concrete. And then in terms of the floor, we'll run it right up to the face of the studs too. Okay, so when we're putting a floor in here, the way to make that happen, and it's easy to fix if we get it wrong, but it's actually even easier if you set it up with the right settings first. We'll say floor. We'll choose, I'm going to do my wood finish floor, that's fine. I'm going to do this extend into the core, instead of the wall core. What happens then is when you click on the wall, choose my wall, it'll go to not the outside face, it'll go to that face where the studs are. Okay, and that's just going to save us some time. If it lines up there, it won't bleed through. So what we'll do, let me zoom and fit this, is I'll go through and grab these other walls. Okay, I still need to do a little trimming just to clean it all up, because all these pink line floors need to have a nice clean boundary. So I'll trim that. Great. And now when I finish the floor, I'm going to say no to that right now. We'll later say yes to that, but we're going to say no to it for right now.
What was the message that popped up?
Would you like to attach the walls to the floor, or attach the walls to it that are connected to the bottom of the floor? And I'll explain that in just a second, because it's true. That's actually it's a good choice in the long run to do it that way. Let's talk about what's happening here. So now, what's interesting, it's still sort of doing its thing. Well, it's because of the overlap there. It is in the right spot, but it is overlapping there. So it's interesting. It's not showing you as clear as it is. Well, I'll fix the total detail because I'm halfway through. So what we were doing in this overall thing is just talking about these two floor walls. And the idea with the two floor walls is, just to kind of give you the same sense, on the lower floor, What I tend to do is just go through and put in a concrete wall, because a concrete wall makes sense. You're going to be underground and you're going to be holding back some earth. So I'll put in a wall. I'll just do another little section over here as though I'm doing a garage or something like that. So here's my lower floor walls. And the idea for the lower floor walls is make sure that the location line is set to core face exterior. The reason that's so good is that when we copy the walls up, they'll also be core face exterior. So when we change them, it'll hold that line. Okay, so here's my little garage. What I'm going to do is take those walls and just copy them up to the second level. But on the second level, they don't have to be concrete anymore. Copy. I'm going to paste aligned to upper level. Okay, so that'll save you some time. Now, those are perfectly aligned, but when I go through and change those to be wood walls, what I can do is, since they're already set to be core face exterior, when you apply the wood wall, it'll actually pop out a little, which is sort of what you really want it to do. You want that little bit of overhang, because you really want the outside edge to hang over. That way, if water is leaking down, it doesn't hit that joint. It kind of makes a clean connection in the end. So it's generally like that. So what we want to have, ultimately, is a connection between the walls that looks like this. We'll say if I draw a section through here, and this is what I always end up doing when we're debugging these models, is we end up drawing some sections.
You draw the sections even though you're not complete with the...
Oh, exactly. I just draw sections all the time as a way just to work and sort of see how things are looking. So over here, if I look back over here, currently it's kind of looking a little blocky because it's coarse level view. If I say fine, you could actually sort of see, okay, a little bit more how things are going. So you can sort of see here's the face of the stud. Here's the concrete, here's the floor. And it goes, welcome back. Now, it's not quite right yet in terms of how you want it to be, so let's go ahead and kind of fix those last couple of things. It's a little sort of messy here in the corner because we actually have several things that we have a floor, we have the concrete wall, they're all sort of overlapping now. So that actually gets to the question that it was asking. It asked, hey, this is actually a floor, you're intersecting with some walls, would you like to cut them off so that they stop at the bottom of the floor? And the answer is generally, come on, Tom, it's fine. The answer generally is yes, that is a good thing to do. So let me get that to happen again. What you can do is I can just choose that and say attach it, and that'll work. Or what tends to happen is as you're working and you edit that boundary of the floor, let me just cut a hole in the floor as though I was going to do something. If I make any change to the floor, it'll usually ask me, would you like to do that? So in general, the answer is yes. Okay, so what that's going to do is it's going to take the lower floor walls and it's going to stop them at the bottom of the floor. Okay, so I'll say yes this time.
The bottom of the second floor.
Correct.
Okay.
Which is sort of the ceiling of the first floor?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's actually not too bad. What happens though when we do that, just so you see, is that okay, that's not too bad. That's looking clean, okay. The difference though, the problem now, let me look at it in 3D though too, just so you sort of see it over there. So, again, you know, not looking too bad, okay. But my floor's looking a little naked out there on the outside, okay, because it's sort of hanging out there, it's not covered with its skin, okay. So what I need to do is just do another little adjustment to kind of make it all completely work. What I'm going to do is keep the walls and lower them down a little bit and kind of clean up that detail. So the distance that we need is the width of the floor, the depth of the floor, since the depth of the floor is how much got chopped away. So the final step to really make this detail look good is to figure out the floor. The floor is, for me, it's 10 and 3 quarters, whatever your floor is. And I'll choose this wall, and I'll say the bottom of this wall starts at minus 10¾. Okay, and when you do that, that gives you this very clean detail. So even here, what I'm gonna do is gonna grab them, zoom out. I'll grab you, it looks like I already got you, so I'm gonna grab you, control. And say 10¾.
Okay.
And that makes a very clean detail. Yes.
Extending the whole wall or just the outer
actually,
siding?
You are so right on target in terms of your question, because right now it actually has extended the whole wall. Okay, but we'll fix that. See, you have a very good sense about what's going on here and like where the hole in this whole scenario is, but let's figure it out. So here we are. You're right on target. Oops. Like, hey, okay, close, but still not quite perfect because I got that little bit of overlap here still. So sometimes when you're editing the floor, it will give you one more question which says that this overlaps like that. Would you like to cut out the volume? Okay, and that's generally a good answer, yes. If we've done it in this order and it's not asking that question, the other way to do it is, I always have to remember whether it's considered a join or whether it's considered a subtraction. Let me try joining. I'll try joining this to that, okay, and it actually did it that way. Now, that is a really good looking detail that is just steps away from being a real true construction detail. That we got that coming on down just fine. The joists are sitting on top of the concrete. We have the subfloor going out to the end of the joists. We have the sheathing coming up on the outside. The siding's wrapping all the way down the floor. Yeah, that's a really good looking detail. About the only thing missing is we actually tend to run like another 2 or 3 inches further and a little piece of flashing down there, just to really make sure that no water gets into that detail. But, you know, for the purposes of what we're doing, this is A-okay. So I guess the high level message to you would be, at a starting point, just go ahead and just be cautious about that alignment, the core face, as opposed to the external surface, and hold the floor back to the face, and then all of this little sort of push up, pull down, we do a little just messing around with that at the end, just to kind of clean it up and make sure all the edges are good. Oh, another way, just to finish with this, that you can sort of tell whether things are good or bad in terms of this is, let me on my lower floor put a couple interior walls in. Okay, let's just say I'm gonna put some like interior 2x4s with studs. Got it. So I have some interior walls just inside the house. Okay, blocking out bedrooms or hallways or whatever's down in there. If I look at that now, watch it. See what the side, what did it say, what the height was? Oh, it says unconnected. Usually I make them up to upper level. Another sign that you needed to change things is this. Can you see that the walls sort of bleed up into the floor too? Okay, not to worry. The way to fix that is to choose the walls and say attach them. This is what the question was asking. Should I attach it to the bottom of the floor? And the answer is yes. And now you got a nice clean detail. They're stopping at the bottom. So again, in that section, zoom out. What's going on? Oh, I've drawn really at a funny spot. Okay. But again, that's going to be matching it up just fine. Like here's that wall right there. Yeah, it's kind of coming up just where it needs to. Beauty. So that was it for today in terms of what's going on. I'll stop the recording now. I'm gonna meet with Rami a little bit. I have an appointment with her, but I'm gonna be here like all afternoon.
Oh, great.
So if you have any questions and want to come in and just ask anything,
great.
We can do any personal consulting you like.
Okay, thank you so much. This is so helpful, even though I was gone.
That's you're most welcome.